The Dean Martin Celebrity Roast, coming to you from the MGM Grand Hotel in the entertainment capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada. The glittering city of excitement and laughter provides the scintillating backdrop for tonight's star-studded roast. Ladies and gentlemen, from the Ziegfeld Room of the Grand Hotel, some of the world's greatest entertainers are here tonight. They are in Las Vegas in person as Dean Martin honors our man of the hour, Dennis Weaver, with tonight's guests, Milburn Stone, Amanda Blake, Rich Little, Steve Forrest, Zsa Zsa Gabor, Shelley Winters, Milton Berle, George Hamilton, Red Button, Martin Milner, Nipsey Russell, K.D. Cannon, Mike Connor, Georgia Engel, William Conrad, Peter Gray, Sheldon Leonard, Jim Hutton, and your roastmaster, Dean Martin, with tonight's very special man of the hour, Dennis Weaver.
Dennis, a lot of your friends couldn't be here tonight. Boy, are they lucky. So they sent some liars, and I'd like to read a few of them. Dear Dennis, we love having you on the New York City police force, and we'll do everything in our power to see that you remain with the New York Police Department. Signed, the New Mexico Police Department. Oh, and here's one with heart and tendons. It says, Dear Dennis, get off my back. Signed, your horse. Here's another one from your pal, Jim Arnaeus. He's 6'12", you know. Dear Dennis, never had the opportunity to tell you how much I admire your courage in quitting a hit show, like Gunsmoke. I was totally surprised that you're leaving, because I just found out about it this morning. Our first guest needs no introduction, so to hell with him. The reason I say the hell with him is because he didn't show up, that's why. So rolling right along. You all know that William Conrad plays a fat detective named Canyon. But you may not know that he almost did another cop show based on his weight. Hawaii 500. We've seen a lot of television, big guns. Now, here's the howitzer, Cannon.
I saw you this morning at the health club here at the MGM Grand. You want to know something? It's the first time I've ever seen anyone go directly from push-ups to intensive care. Dennis has a reputation for being a family man, a health enthusiast, and an all-round nice guy. And because I'm a private detective, I was asked to shadow Dennis Weaver for a whole day and find out what he is really like. Here is my report. 5:30 a.m. Subject awoke. Did an hour of exercise and then did 30 laps in the swimming pool. observed that Weaver wears a bathing cap, a little bikini for his mustache, and uses Snoopy water wings. By the way, the pool was built according to Dennis Weaver's own personality. It's completely shallow. 8:30. Weaver stopped at the home of Jim Arness, where he wrote obscene Western expressions on the front door. 1:30. Weaver entered NBC to suggest his hosting a comedy show. 1:31, Weaver thrown out. 10 o'clock, subject at home in his own bedroom, he was being watched by a peeping Tom. Note, the peeping Tom fell asleep. Final evaluation. After shadowing Dennis Weaver for 18 hours, I find his shadow is a hell of a lot more interesting than he is.
We're fortunate in having Shelley Winters with us because she hates to do television. These hot lights take all the stretch out of her orthopedic stockings. Miss Shelley Winters.
Thank you, Dean, for that lovely introduction. You know, fellow Americans, in this our bicentennial year, Congress has discovered that Dean drinks so much, they're trying to pass legislation forbidding him to exhale. They have at last found out that he is destroying the ozone layer. I've really looked forward to coming here tonight to roast and honor Dennis Weaver, because I probably know Dennis Weaver longer than any person on this dais. Dennis and I met many years ago at the Actors Studio in New York, and I saw that he had a great deal of acting potential. Without any selfishness on my part, I personally arranged for his screen test, his first screen test. Isn't that right, Dennis?
I don't ad lib.
Since our young days. You know, Dennis's idea of a big evening now is to go to a health food store, have a double shot of carrot juice, and watch your lettuce wilt. In all the years I've known him, he's only done one nice thing for me. He didn't get me a part in Kentucky Jones. I like that show. And the fact was that he never had to use drugs to anesthetize the animals. His acting put them to sleep. Actually, I shouldn't kid about Dennis's acting. He always takes his roles very seriously. He's trained, method actor. You know, he did a movie called The Great Man's Whiskers. He played Abraham Lincoln. And Dennis has started to live the role of Lincoln. As a matter of fact, the other night here in Vegas, I heard him trying to convince Gladys Knight to free the Pips. On the Plow, Dennis has one of the most demanding detective shows on television. Each week for the past 3 years, he's had to look for the plot.
There was a TV show called SWAT. I thought it was about flies. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one of the stars of SWAT, Mr. Steve Forrest.
I suppose I was asked here because of my lifelong friendship with Dennis Weaver. Whichever one of the gentlemen on the dais that is. No, actually, I was asked here basically because I play a cop. A real cop. Not like most of the guys on the dais. Private eyes. No real toughness. I mean, look at Mannix. For 10 years, no real excitement. Every week, some same thing with Mannix. He's pushed out of a car at the end of the first act. He spends the rest of the show shaking his head to clear it. And when he finds out who he is, the show is over. Cannon is not bad. He's pretty gutty. He's got so much, he can't find shorts for them. Real cops. That's the kind of part to play. Not Peter Graves in that Mission Impossible phony stuff. First 2 minutes of the show, Peter listens to a record. For the next hour, he relaxes watching Greg Morris change fuses while Peter Lupus holds up the building.
Mr. Red Button. Tonight I find myself on a dais with five great detectives. Gathered here to solve the greatest mystery of all times. Why are we honoring Dennis Weaver? But I must say that I am a little disturbed that they would give this man a roast when some of the greatest people in the history of the world never got a dinner. Never got a dinner, yes, I'll name him right now. Billy Graham. Billy Graham, who once said about Frank Sinatra, "There, but for the grace of me goes God." Willie Shoemaker, who once said to Mickey Rooney, "When you gonna grow up?" Never got a dinner. Alexander Graham Bell, who once said to Thomas Edison, "How come there's no light in his phone booth?" Mr. Weaver, I don't know you too well, and I certainly intend to keep it that way. I followed your career, and I'm familiar, very familiar with your many awards. I remember when you got the Emmy for the best supporting limp. I don't even know how you got that limp. You once tried to get something from Kitty that didn't come in a shot glass.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's a guy who can use any name he wants on a motel register and get away with it.
Mr. Rich Little.
Let's face it, that McCloud outfit and Six Gun are completely out of place in New York City. I mean, when was the last time you heard John Wayne yell, "All right, partners, we'll head them off at the Hotel Pierre." And tell me, Dennis, don't you feel embarrassed when you raid a building and have to make excuses?
Well, I just don't understand what you're talking about. I mean, what do you mean I can't bring a horse into an elevator? Now, Well, he ain't smoking and he's facing front.
It's just not gonna work, Dennis. I mean, you should have stuck with Gunsmoke. I mean, you were really great as Matt Dillon's sidekick.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's true, Reg, but I just got sick and tired of being kicked in the side.
No, I think your detective character, Dennis, needs a completely different approach. Maybe a style like Peter Falk in Columbo.
Ah, excuse me, sir. I know that you're the murderer. You'd better come with me right away. Oh, by the way, that's a really nice looking gun that you're pointing at me.
Now, Dennis, let's face it. That McLeod character is just not going to work. I mean, it's about as out of place as Truman Capote trying to be a detective.
You criminal crook.
I'm going to beat you within an inch of your life. Because it's because of you I talk this way. You see, you're the creep who sold me these tight shorts.
In fact, let me tell you something, Dennis. There's a lot of other people who could give a completely different approach to McLeod. For instance, Paul Lynn as a detective.
Hi. Is that the victim lying there in that Charisse safari suit? The puce body shirt and the mocha suede Gucci's? Well, I know what he died of. Bad taste.
Many people in our industry have said that Mike Connors is a consummate thespian. I won't contradict that because I don't know what thespian means. Boy, I wish I was here.
To say a few words about McLeod.
Hi, Dennis. Now, look, I don't know about the rest of you on the dais here, how you got here, but as for me, I want to tell you how Dennis got me here. In my case, it all began with a letter. At first, I thought this was just a piece of junk mail. And then I saw it was from Dennis Weaver, and I knew it was junk mail. Now, as I started to read this letter, it was obvious to me that, well, Dennis was actually kind of searching for some people to be here on the dais tonight. Really looking. I don't want to imply that he was desperate, and he sent these letters to a lot of people. But the invitation began, "Dear Occupant." Don't you bother reserving a room. You'll be sharing my suite. Well, let me tell you, folks, I am sharing your suite, and I'll never do it again. I mean, all night long, his horse keeps kicking the blankets off of the bed. Oh, and Dennis, by the way, I think you better rush out to the lobby. Your horse was just picked up on a 502. That's molesting a Mustang.
Ladies and gentlemen, one of Hollywood's finest actors, Mr. Milton Berle, Stone Berle Milton, Milburn Stern.
Dennis, Amanda, this is really like old times. You know, you sitting there on your duffs and me working.
Gunsmoke started to go up in the ratings, it was then the famous Dennis Weaver ego was born. I'll give you an example. Very short time later, he came to me and he said, Milburn, I'm going to have my own show someday. Well, I humored him. I said, okay, Dennis, what's it going to be called? He said, Gunsmoke. It was then that he started his legendary Dump Our Nest campaign.
Don't believe it, Jim. Don't believe it.
Little simple things at first, like he turned out the lights while Jim was cleaning his gun. Little things like that. If anybody's wondering why Jim isn't here, well, Dean asked me to invite him, and I did. Jim said, well, he'd like to come on the show, but he didn't know what to do. And I said, well, all you have to do is come on the show and insult Dennis. Say nasty things about it. And he said, what show is it, to tell the truth? Eventually, Dennis rode out of Dodge City for the last time. Now, for the rest of us on the show, after we'd polished off all the champagne, we put up some barricades to make sure he didn't change his mind.
Some years ago on the Gunsmoke series, they auditioned a lot of dance hall girls for the Long Branch Saloon. With us tonight is one of those young girls who, you know, one of those young dancing girls. Here she is to tell us her very unique story, ladies and gentlemen, Miss Gladys Ormsby.
I heard what he said about me backstage. He told everybody I looked like a gold digger. John Sutter. You, Roman Rummy, be quiet. You could have had all of this also, Dennis. That's right. I offered him my lips, my heart, my soul, but he decided to go for what's behind door number two. And he got what he deserved, a toaster and a picture of George Hamilton for his wallet. I'll never forget the day I auditioned. I walked out on that Long Branch stage in my leotards. Ah, hold it down over there. I tell you, I turned quite a few heads.
And quite a few stomachs.
He told me I was beautiful. He made my bosom swell. That was something I always wanted. A swell bosom. You know, I became his completely. Why? I don't know. He was so conceited. Every night, he'd walk into the girls' dressing room and say, Dennis, anyone? You know, I remember the first gift he gave me. He asked me if I wanted a fur coat. I said, yes. So he gave me a razor and told me to go and shave Gentle Ben. And our first Christmas together, he bought me two silver bowls. One marked food and the other marked water. You insensitive monster. You know, I told him I wanted a white Christmas. He shoved me into a bowl of cheese dip. Years. Do you think it was fun for me going with a guy who's got a limp? I'll tell you, it was a drag.
Thank You shouldn't have dressed just to come here.
I'll take it here.
Lovely. Our next guest, Nippus here, Russell. He a black performer. He's the only black comedian without his own situation comedy. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one of the funniest guys in show business, my pal.
I only have one thing to say to you, Mr. McLeod. Don't ride that damn horse through Harlem no more. People in Harlem were celebrating. They were playing James Brown's record. Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud. And here he comes on the horse. Do you know they thought you were the white knight and that you were going to make everybody white? Now it's beautiful to be black. Nobody wants to be bleached. Now, I just want to direct most of my commentary to this assemblage of great television policemen. Gentlemen, your concept of law enforcement is all wrong, and the jury trial is a joke. How can you lock 12 men and women in a hotel overnight, and they come out and say, not guilty? Huh. Now, since they have announced the budget crisis in New York, we black people have learned something about the police. We didn't know the city was paying them, too. Well, you know, it's not just in New York. Right here last night at the MGM Grand Hotel, we got a phone call. It said, hurry over with help. There's a burglar trapped in Tody Field's house, and we think there's a plan for sexual violence. Hurry up. We said, we're coming. Is this Tody Field's talking? He said, no, this is the burglar. I have totally omitted any reference to the whole Gunsmoke thing. There's been a great disservice done to my people in the historical context of all the Westerns on television. Now, you know General Custer was black when he got the little bighorn and saw all the Indians in the world waiting for him, then he turned white. So I say to you, McLeod, go on with your great series. Don't worry about a losing streak, because even if your ratings fall down, Columbo will pick them up next week.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure for me to introduce the poster girl for Cartier, the lovely Miss Zsa Zsa Gabor.
I watch all of your shows and I love them. But you know what you really need is a policewoman for a partner like me. After all, who knows more about getting her man than I do? And I will be a very honest cop. Who can afford to bribe me? Believe me, I know all about police work. I always hear you say 10:40, 9:11, 2:36. I have been in every one of those hotel rooms. Well, let's face it, darling. Nobody could ever accuse me of carrying concealed weapons. Dennis, darling, I'm an original member of the SWAT team. SWAT, Selby at Tiffany's. I love you.
Zsa Gabor. We're staying here at the MGM Grand Hotel in the honeymoon suite as an instructor. Georgia Engel. She is the sweetest and the nicest lady you have ever seen. In fact, she's so nice that whenever she breaks an egg, she sends a get well card to the chicken. Georgia Engel. Georgia.
To do this Dennis Weaver roast, they asked me to come up with some hard-hitting zingers. Well, I thought and I thought and I thought, but I still couldn't zing right, so the producer gave me things to say about the people on the dais. Some raps, some slams, and some put-down shtick. Here's the first one. I see Milton Berle sitting over there in a tuxedo. I guess his dress didn't come back from the cleaners.
Was a good zinger.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Burrell. You know, I don't know why they keep on poking fun of you because you wear dresses on television. I've always thought you have a lovely figure. Well, here's another zinger. And how do you like Zsa Zsa Gabor's hair color? I don't know where she gets it done, but last week I saw her coming out of Earl Shives. That wasn't very nice. Your hair looks so perfectly natural, especially at the roots. I understand that Dean Martin was recently honored in Hollywood, where they put stars' names on the sidewalk. Dean was the first one to get his name in the gutter. Thing to say, Mr. Martin. I can't picture you anyway except spread out on the sidewalk. And now we come to our guest of honor, Dennis Weaver. Dennis is really a health nut. In fact, he eats so much health food that when he dies, he's not going to be buried, he's going to be blended. Just before the show, he gave me one of his health drinks. Half of it was desiccated liver, brewer's yeast, and texturized vegetable protein, and the other half was tomato juice. It's called a bloody mess.
Gentlemen, a glamorous lady, a fine actress, the queen of Gunsmoke, Miss Amanda Blake.
Thank you, Dean. You know, I always love to do your show here at the MGM Grand. It's really the most magnificent place in Las Vegas. It makes all the other hotels look like the Long Branch. Dennis, of course, created the part of Chester, a slow-witted character with a limp. In doing so, he drew upon his past experiences. The limp he perfected during the war, when he appeared before his draft board. But that was Chester, slow-witted with a limp. Not to be confused with the real-life Dennis, who does not limp. Of course, Dennis became immensely popular as Chester, but his success didn't change him. he still treated us with the same petty jealousy he always had. For example, Milburn, Jim Arness, and I all had air conditioners in our dressing rooms. So Dennis demanded that he wanted one too, but they turned him down because they were afraid the horses would catch cold. But things have changed for Dennis. He's the star of his own series, McCloud. And now he has a huge dressing room with air conditioning and a barrel of Dristan for his horse.
By the way, Amanda is no relation to Robert Blake. Robert asked me to say that.
Ladies and gentlemen, one of TV's most popular and most capable actors, my wonderful buddy, Mr. Peter Graves.
I didn't hear that I'd say a lot of nice things about Dennis, but I told him that I'm through with Mission Impossible. Well, I'm happy that tonight I'm the one who gets to tell you that the Patrol Women's Benevolent Association has voted you the best-looking police officer on television. I was supposed to present you with the award tonight, but they're having trouble getting it back from last year's winner, Carl Malden. Now, just before the show, I was talking with the president of that group, and I agree with her. I think that McCloud has been the victim of a lot of cruel and undue criticism tonight. I've seen every one of your shows, and I love both the plots. Now, everybody watches McCloud these days, of course. In fact, McCloud's ratings are so good that they're planning a spinoff, and it's based on Dennis's sexual relationship with his girlfriend, Barbara. It's called The Rookies.
McCloud, Dennis Weaver doesn't really hang from helicopters, jump from buildings, and chase people on horseback. He has a stuntman to do all those dangerous things. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Dennis Weaver's stuntman, a guy with real courage and nerves of steel, Mr. Foster Brooks.
Stuntman on the cloud right from the very beginning. And you know what? Why? Because he's chicken. Now let me tell you a few things about the faint-hearted fuzz. And you want to know something else about Dennis? He's afraid of horses. You think he's not scared? He won't even get on one unless he's wearing Pampers. Do you want to know something else? You want to know something else about him? That isn't even his voice. His real voice is extremely high-pitched. For a long time, he was known as Denise Weaver. One final bit of information regarding my job. As you know, the inadequate investigator here has three kids. That was my greatest stunt.
The man who pioneered television, Mr. Tuesday Night, and I say Mr. Milton Berle.
You call me Mr. Tuesday night?
It's funny, that's what my wife still calls me. You did it again, Dean. What a night. There's more losers at this table than are out there in the casino. It's like a live wax museum. Look who's the man of the week. Dennis Weaver. Poor soul, he thinks the happy hooker specializes in needlepoint. Incidentally, Dennis, I have regards for you from Guy Lombardo. He told me when he dies, he's going to take New Year's Eve with him. That's a joke I used 30 years ago. And there's not too many things I used 30 years ago that I can still use, but I would like. Sergeant, I hear you feel like a new man. And look, wait, Dennis. Will you look at me, please, please? Look at the people that showed up for you tonight. Bill Conrad, where is he? Sitting over there under very difficult circumstances. Any minute he could give birth from the front, he looks like Toady Fields from the back. And then there's lovely Ruth Buzzy, the fashion coordinator for the Walton family. God, she could make veils popular again. George Hamilton. Hamilton is the only one I know that makes movies that are immediately shown on the Late Late Show. Manic, great detective. He couldn't find Raquel Welch in a phone booth. There's Jim Hutton. Hillary Queen. Jim, stop talking to that beautiful girl. Star of Hillary Queen. He has the only show that's listed in TV Guide in pencil. My pal, Nipsey Russell, sitting over there smiling at everybody with Burt Lancaster's teeth. Look at him. Nipsey has gums that shine. Well, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said Nipsey and Shine in the same voice. Okay. Right, I want to tell you about your friend, Mr. Remember us, the defiant ones? What is Amanda Blake doing here besides being a... I mean, she doesn't need this. She's a very rich woman. She made a fortune endorsing kitty litter. And I think... Here's another one you may not care for. I'm laughing at the next joke because I heard it. Glad to see the two and only Zsa Zsa. Sitting over there wearing a rented bracelet. Girl, Zsa Zsa. My girl. Everybody's girl. Zsa Zsa's been married so many times, she's got rice marks on her face. It's an old joke. Well, who am I talking to? Shelley Winters. Lovely, she and I go back a very long time. Shelley used to travel with the Tommy Dorsey band. She didn't sing, she just liked to travel with the band. And now we get to our guest of honor. When they call out the names of the great actors, Marlon Brando, Sir Laurence Olivier, Paul Newman, Dennis, you'll be there.
listening.
One of the most respected and talented stars and actors of our profession, Mr. Dennis Weaver.
You know, I really didn't think it was possible for a group of entertainers like yourself to get together and do funny jokes about me for an hour. And I was right. You know, I look forward to being here because, well, to be very truthful with you, I feel a great kinship with the Dean. We both love doing westerns. We both have a 10-gallon hat. Except Dean's has a cork in it. Anyway, I'm happy to see my friend Peter Graves here. As you know, Peter is James Arnett's brother. You can see a very definite family resemblance. They're both out of work. Milburn Stone, my old friend from Gunsmoke, Milburn Stone, you know, I tell you that, Milbert, he's really got a down-home sense of humor. And I think that's where he left it. And Georgia Engel. Oh, listen, I always watch you on the Mary Tyler Moore Show, always. I really like that, Georgia. She's so friendly. You know, she starts sing-alongs in crowded elevators. And gracing this dais tonight is another alumnus of Gunsmoke, Amanda Blake. You came here out of affection. You also came here out of material. And Bill Conrad, I remember when they roasted you on this show. I didn't think they could find a rotisserie that was big enough. Nixie Russell, you are the best at what you do. I just wish I knew what it was. I knew I'd see Shelley Winters here. Last night, 3:00 in the morning, I saw Shelley. She's getting into an elevator with a handy six-pack. She had three guys under each arm. You know, if there's anything that makes me sad and sometimes makes me a little mad, it's hearing people say that Milton Berle isn't funny. You know, I mean, heck, he knows that. Steve Forrest, you know, he's the star of SWAT, SWAT. Every week, he breaks down doors, he knocks people over, and he holds a gun on them. You know, just the same way that he gets all of his jobs on television. And Marty Milner. Yeah. Yeah. You know, Marty, the fact that you flew up here to the MGM Grand proves something very, very special to me. You need work. Zsa Zsa, hey, you know, Zsa Zsa, you got more laughs tonight than the last time you said, "I promise to love, honor, and obey." And in conclusion, I'd like to say I wouldn't be here at this MGM Grand Hotel tonight with this dais if it weren't for the fact that Shelley Winters helped to discover me. And Shelley, I'm going to get you for this.
Mr. Dennis Weaver. Thank you.
The Dean Martin Celebrity Roast, coming to you from the MGM Grand Hotel in the entertainment capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada. The glittering city of excitement and laughter provides the scintillating backdrop for tonight's star-studded roast. Ladies and gentlemen, from the Ziegfeld Room of the Grand Hotel, some of the world's greatest entertainers are here tonight. They are in Las Vegas in person as Dean Martin honors our man of the hour, Dennis Weaver, with tonight's guests, Milburn Stone, Amanda Blake, Rich Little, Steve Forrest, Zsa Zsa Gabor, Shelley Winters, Milton Berle, George Hamilton, Red Button, Martin Milner, Nipsey Russell, J.D. Cannon, Mike Connor, Georgia Engel, William Conrad, Peter Gray, Sheldon Leonard, Jim Hutton, and your roastmaster, Dean Martin, with tonight's very special man of the hour, Dennis Weaver.
Dennis, a lot of your friends couldn't be here tonight. Boy, are they lucky. So they sent some wires, and I'd like to read a few of them. Dear Dennis, we love having you on the New York City police force, and we'll do everything in our power to see that you remain with the New York Police Department. Signed, the New Mexico Police Department. Oh, and here's one with heart and tenderness. It says, Dear Dennis, get off my back. Signed, your horse. Here's another one from your pal, Jim Arneas. He's 6'12", you know. Dear Dennis, never had the opportunity to tell you how much I admire your courage in quitting a show, a hit show, like Gunsmoke. I was totally surprised that you're leaving, because I just found out about it this morning. Our first guest needs no introduction, so to hell with him. The reason I say the hell with him is because he didn't show up, that's why. So rolling right along. You all know that William Conrad plays a fat detective named Canyon. But you may not know that he almost did another cop show based on his weight. Hawaii 500. You've seen a lot of television big guns. Now here's the howitzer, Cannon.
I saw you this morning at the health club here at the MGM Grand. You want to know something? It's the first time I've ever seen anyone go directly from push-ups to intensive care. Dennis has a reputation for being a family man, a health enthusiast, and an all-round nice guy. And because I'm a private detective, I was asked to shadow Dennis Weaver for a whole day and find out what he is really like. Here is my report. 5:30 a.m. Subject awoke. Did an hour of exercise and then did 30 laps in the swimming pool. observed that Weaver wears a bathing cap, a little bikini for his mustache, and uses Snoopy water wings. By the way, the pool was built according to Dennis Weaver's own personality. It's completely shallow. 8:30. Weaver stopped at the home of Jim Arness, where he wrote obscene Western expressions on the front door. 1:30. Weaver entered NBC to suggest his hosting a comedy show. 1:31. Weaver thrown out. 10 o'clock. Subject at home in his own bedroom, he was being watched by a peeping Tom. Note, the peeping Tom fell asleep. Final evaluation. After shadowing Dennis Weaver for 18 hours, I find his shadow is a hell of a lot more interesting than he is.
Having Shelley Winters with us because she hates to do television. These hot lights take all the stretch out of her orthopedic stockings. Miss Shelley Winters.
Introduction. You know, fellow Americans, in this our bicentennial year, Congress has discovered that Dean drinks so much, they're trying to pass legislation forbidding him to exhale. They have at last found out that he is destroying the ozone layer. I've really looked forward to coming here tonight to roast and honor Dennis Weaver, because I probably know Dennis Weaver longer than any person on this dais. Dennis and I met many years ago at the Actors Studio in New York, and I saw that he had a great deal of acting potential. Without any selfishness on my part, I personally arranged for his screen test, his first screen test. Isn't that right, Dennis?
I don't ad lib.
Since our young days. You know, Dennis's idea of a big evening now is to go to a health food store, have a double shot of carrot juice, and watch your lettuce wilt. In all the years I've known him, he's only done one nice thing for me. He didn't get me a part in Kentucky Jones. I like that show. And the fact was that he never had to use drugs to anesthetize the animals. His acting put them to sleep. Actually, I shouldn't kid about Dennis's acting. He always takes his roles very seriously. He's trained, method actor. You know, he did a movie called The Great Man's Whiskers. He played Abraham Lincoln. And Dennis has started to live the role of Lincoln. As a matter of fact, the other night here in Vegas, I heard him trying to convince Gladys Knight to free the Pips. On the Plow, Dennis has one of the most demanding detective shows on television. Each week for the past 3 years, he's had to look for the plot.
There was a TV show called SWAT. I thought it was about flies. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one of the stars of SWAT, Mr. Steve Forrest.
suppose I was asked here because of my lifelong friendship with Dennis Weaver. Whichever one of the gentlemen on the dais that is. Now, actually, I was asked here basically because I play a cop. A real cop. Not like most of the guys on the dais. Private eyes. No real toughness. I mean, look at Mannix. For 10 years, no real excitement. Every week, some same thing with Mannix. He's pushed out of a car at the end of the first act. He spends the rest of the show shaking his head to clear it. And when he finds out who he is, the show is over. Cannon is not bad. He's pretty gutty. He's got so much he can't find shorts for them. Real cops. That's the kind of part to play. Not Peter Graves in that Mission Impossible. Phony stuff. First 2 minutes of the show, Peter listens to a record. For the next hour, he relaxes watching Greg Morris change fuses while Peter Lupus holds up the building.
Mr. Red Button. Tonight I find myself on a dais with five great detectives. Gathered here to solve the greatest mystery of all times. Why are we honoring Dennis Weaver? But I must say that I am a little disturbed that they would give this man a roast when some of the greatest people in the history of the world never got a dinner. Never got a dinner, yes, I'll name him right now, Billy Graham. Billy Graham, who once said about Frank Sinatra, "There, but for the grace of me goes God." Willie Shoemaker, who once said to Mickey Rooney, "When you gonna grow up?" Never got a dinner. Alexander Graham Bell, who once said to Thomas Edison, "How come there's no light in his phone booth?"
Mr. Weaver, I don't know you too well, and I certainly intend to keep it that way. I followed your career, and I'm familiar, very familiar with your many awards. I remember when you got the Emmy for the best supporting limp. I don't even know how you got that limp. You once tried to get something from Kitty that didn't come in a shot glass.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's a guy who can use any name he wants on a motel register and get away with it. Mr. Rich Little.
Let's face it, that McCloud outfit and Six Gun are completely out of place in New York City. I mean, when was the last time you heard John Wayne yell, "All right, partners, we'll head them off at the Hotel Pierre"? And tell me, Dennis, don't you feel embarrassed when you raid a building and have to make excuses?
Well, I just don't understand what you're talking about. I mean, what do you mean I can't bring a horse into an elevator? Now, Well, he ain't smoking and he's facing front.
It's just not gonna work, Dennis. I mean, you should have stuck with Gunsmoke. I mean, you were really great as Matt Dillon's sidekick.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's true, Rich, but I just got sick and tired of being kicked in the side.
No, I think your detective character, Dennis, needs a completely different approach. Maybe a style like Peter Falk in Columbo.
Ah, excuse me, sir. I know that you're the murderer. You'd better come with me right away. Oh, by the way, that's a really nice-looking gun that you're pointing at me.
Now, Dennis, let's face it. That McLeod character is just not going to work. I mean, it's about as out of place as Truman Capote trying to be a detective.
You crummy crook. Beat you within an inch of your life. Because it's because of you I talk this way. You see, you're the creep who sold me these tight shorts.
In fact, let me tell you something, Dennis. There's a lot of other people who could give a completely different approach to McLeod. For instance, Paul Lynn as a detective.
Hi. Is that the victim lying there in that Charisse safari suit? The cute body shirt and the mocha suede Gucci's? Well, I know what he died of. Bad taste.
Many people in our industry have said that Mike Connors is a consummate thespian. I won't contradict that because I don't know what thespian means. Boy, I wish I was here.
To say a few words about McLeod.
Hi, Dennis. Now, look, I don't know about the rest of you on the dais here, how you got here, but as for me, I want to tell you how Dennis got me here. In my case, it all began with a letter. At first, I thought this was just a piece of junk mail. And then I saw it was from Dennis Weaver, and I knew it was junk mail. Now, as I started to read this letter, it was obvious to me that, well, Dennis was actually kind of searching for some people to be here on the dais tonight. Really looking. I don't want to imply that he was desperate, and he sent these letters to a lot of people. But the invitation began, "Dear Occupant." Don't you bother reserving a room. You'll be sharing my suite. Well, let me tell you, folks, I am sharing a suite, and I'll never do it again. I mean, all night long, his horse keeps kicking the blankets off of the bed. Oh, and Dennis, by the way, I think you better rush out to the lobby. Your horse was just picked up on a 502. That's molesting a Mustang.
Gentlemen, one of Hollywood's finest actors, Mr. Milton Berle. Stone Berle Milton. Milburn Stern.
Dennis, Amanda, this is really like old times. You know, you sitting there on your duffs and me working.
As Gunsmoke started to go up in the ratings, it was then the famous Dennis Weaver ego was born. I'll give you an example. Very short time later, he came to me and he said, Milburn, I'm going to have my own show someday. Well, I humored him. I said, okay, Dennis, what's it going to be called? And he said, Gunsmoke. It was then that he started his legendary Dump Our Nest campaign.
Don't believe it, Jim. Don't believe it.
Little simple things at first, like he turned out the lights while Jim was cleaning his gun. Little things like that. If anybody's wondering why Jim isn't here, well, Dean asked me to invite him, and I did. Jim said, well, he'd like to come on the show, but he didn't know what to do. And I said, well, all you have to do is come on the show and insult Dennis. Say nasty things about it. And he says, what show is it, to tell the truth? Eventually, Dennis rode out of Dodge City for the last time. Now, for the rest of us on the show, after we'd polished off all the champagne, we put up some barricades to make sure he didn't change his mind.
On the Gunsmoke series, they auditioned a lot of dance hall girls for the Long Branch Saloon. With us tonight is one of those young girls who, you know, one of those young dancing girls. Here she is to tell us her very unique story, ladies and gentlemen, Miss Gladys Ormsby.
About me backstage. He told everybody I looked like a gold digger. John Sutter. No, Roman Rummy, be quiet. You could have had all of this also, Dennis. That's right. I offered him my lips, my heart, my soul, but he decided to go for what's behind door number two. And he got what he deserved, a toaster and a picture of George Hamilton for his wallet. I'll never forget the day I auditioned. I walked out on that Long Branch stage in my leotards. Ah, hold it down over there. I tell you, I turned quite a few heads.
And quite a few stomachs.
He told me I was beautiful. He made my bosom swell. That was something I always wanted. A swell bosom. You know, I became his completely. Why? I don't know. He was so conceited. Every night he'd walk into the girls' dressing room and say, Dennis, anyone? You know, I remember the first gift he gave me. He asked me if I wanted a fur coat. I said, yes. So he gave me a razor and told me to go and shave Gentle Ben. And our first Christmas together, he bought me two silver bowls. One marked food and the other marked water. You insensitive monster. You know, I told him I wanted a white Christmas. He shoved me into a bowl of cheese dip. Years. Do you think it was fun for me going with a guy who's got a limp? I'll tell you, it was a drag.
shouldn't have dressed just to come here. Our next guest, Nippus here, Russell. He a black performer. He's the only black comedian without his own situation comedy. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one of the funniest guys in show business, my pal.
Thing to say to you, Mr. McCloud, don't ride that damn horse through Harlem no more. The black people in Harlem were celebrating, they were playing James Brown's record. Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud. And here he comes on the horse. Do you know they thought you were the white knight and that you were gonna make everybody white? Now it's beautiful to be black, nobody wants to be bleached. My commentary to this assemblage of great television policemen. Gentlemen, your concept of law enforcement is all wrong, and the jury trial is a joke. How can you lock 12 men and women in a hotel overnight and they come out and say, not guilty? Huh. Now, since they have announced the budget crisis in New York, we black people have learned something about the police. We didn't know the city was paying them, too. Well, you know, it's not just in New York. Right here last night at the MGM Grand Hotel, we got a phone call. It said, hurry over with help. There's a burglar trapped in Tody Field's house, and we think there's a plan for sexual violence. Hurry up. We said, well...
The Dean Martin Celebrity Roast, coming to you from the MGM Grand Hotel in the entertainment capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada. The glittering city of excitement and laughter provides the scintillating backdrop for tonight's star-studded roast. Ladies and gentlemen, from the Ziegfeld Room of the Grand Hotel, some of the world's greatest entertainers are here tonight. They are in Las Vegas in person, as Dean Martin honors our man of the hour, Dennis Weaver, with tonight's guests, Milburn Stone, Amanda Blake, Rich Little, Steve Forrest, Zsa Zsa Gabor, Shelley Winters, Milton Berle, George Hamilton, Red Button, Martin Milner, Nipsey Russell, K.D. Cannon, Mike Connor, Georgia Engel, William Conrad, Peter Gray, Sheldon Leonard, Jim Hutton, and your roastmaster, Dean Martin, with tonight's very special man of the hour, Dennis Weaver.
Dennis, a lot of your friends couldn't be here tonight. Boy, are they lucky. So they sent some wires, and I'd like to read a few of them. Dear Dennis, we love having you on the New York City Police Force, and we'll do everything in our power to see that you remain with the New York Police Department. Signed, the New Mexico Police Department. Oh, and here's one with heart and tendons. It says, Dear Dennis, get off my back. Signed, your horse. Here's another one from your pal, Jim Arnaeus. He's 6'12", you know.
You, Dennis, never had the opportunity to tell you how much I admire your courage in quitting a show, a hit show, like Gunsmoke. I was totally surprised at your leaving, because I just found out about it this morning. Our first guest needs no introduction, so to hell with him. The reason I say the hell with him is because he didn't show up, that's why.
So rolling right along.
You all know that William Conrad plays a fat detective named Canyon. But you may not know that he almost did another cop show based on his weight, Hawaii 500. You've seen a lot of television, big guns. Now, here's the howitzer, Ken.
I saw you this morning at the health club here at the MGM Grand. You want to know something? It's the first time I've ever seen anyone go directly from push-ups to intensive care. Dennis has a reputation for being a family man, a health enthusiast, and an all-round nice guy. And because I'm a private detective, I was asked to shadow Dennis Weaver for a whole day and find out what he is really like. Here is my report. 5:30 a.m. Subject awoke. Did an hour of exercise, and then did 30 laps in the swimming pool. Observed that Weaver wears a bathing cap, a little bikini for his mustache, and uses Snoopy water wings. By the way, the pool was built according to Dennis Weaver's own personality. It's completely shallow. 8:30. Weaver stopped at the home of Jim Arness, where he wrote obscene Western expressions on the front door. 1:30. Weaver entered NBC to suggest his hosting a comedy show. 1:31. Weaver thrown out. 10 o'clock. Subject at home in his own bedroom. He was being watched by a peeping Tom. Note, the peeping Tom fell asleep. Final evaluation. After shadowing Dennis Weaver for 18 hours, I find his shadow is a hell of a lot more interesting than he is.
Having Shelley Winters with us because she hates to do television. These hot lights take all the stretch out of her orthopedic stockings. Miss Shelley Winters.
Introduction. You know, fellow Americans, in this our bicentennial year, Congress has discovered that Dean drinks so much, they're trying to pass legislation forbidding him to exhale. They have at last found out that he is destroying the ozone layer. I've really looked forward to coming here tonight to roast and honor Dennis Weaver, because I probably know Dennis Weaver longer than any person on this dais. Dennis and I met many years ago at the Actors Studio in New York, and I saw that he had a great deal of acting potential. Without any selfishness on my part, I personally arranged for his screen test, his first screen test. Isn't that right, Dennis?
I don't ad lib.
Since our young days. You know, Dennis's idea of a big evening now is to go to a health food store, have a double shot of carrot juice, and watch a lettuce wilt. In all the years I've known him, he's only done one nice thing for me. He didn't get me a part in Kentucky Jones. I like that show. And the fact was that he never had to use drugs to anesthetize the animals. His acting put them to sleep. Actually, I shouldn't kid about Dennis's acting. He always takes his roles very seriously. He's trained, method actor. You know, he did a movie called The Great Man's Whiskers. He played Abraham Lincoln. And Dennis has started to live the role of Lincoln. As a matter of fact, the other night here in Vegas, I heard him trying to convince Gladys Knight to free the Pips. On the Plow, Dennis has one of the most demanding detective shows on television. Each week for the past 3 years, he's had to look for the plot.
There was a TV show called SWAT. I thought it was about flies. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one of the stars of SWAT, Mr. Steve Forrest.
I suppose I was asked here because of my lifelong friendship with Dennis Weaver. Whichever one of the gentlemen on the dais, that is. No, actually, I was asked here basically because I play a cop. A real cop. Not like most of the guys on the dais. Private eyes. No real toughness. I mean, look at Mannix. For 10 years, no real excitement. Every week, same thing with Mannix. He's pushed out of a car at the end of the first act. He spends the rest of the show shaking his head to clear it. And when he finds out who he is, the show is over. Cannon is not bad. He's pretty gutty. He's got so much he can't find shorts for them. Real cops. That's the kind of part to play. Not Peter Graves in that Mission Impossible phony stuff. First 2 minutes of the show, Peter listens to a record. For the next hour, he relaxes watching Greg Morris change fuses while Peter Lupus holds up the building.
Mr. Red Button. Tonight I find myself on a dais with five great detectives. Gathered here to solve the greatest mystery of all times. Why are we honoring Dennis Weaver? But I must say that I am a little disturbed that they would give this man a roast when some of the greatest people in the history of the world never got a dinner. Never got a dinner, yes, I'll name him right now, Billy Graham. Billy Graham, who once said about Frank Sinatra, "There, but for the grace of me goes God." Dinner.
Willie Shoemaker who once said to Mickey Rooney, when you gonna grow up? Never got a dinner. Alexander Graham Bell who once said to Thomas Edison, how come there's no light in his phone booth?
Mr. Weaver, I don't know you too well, and I certainly intend to keep it that way. But I followed your career, and I'm familiar, very familiar with your many awards. I remember when you got the Emmy for the best supporting limp. I don't even know how you got that limp. You once tried to get something from Kitty that didn't come in a shot glass.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's a guy who can use any name he wants on a motel register and get away with it. Mr. Rich Little.
Let's face it, that McCloud outfit and Six Gun are completely out of place in New York City. I mean, when was the last time you heard John Wayne yell,
all right, partners, we'll head them off at the Hotel Pierre.
And tell me, Dennis, don't you feel embarrassed when you raid a building and have to make excuses?
Well, I just don't understand what you're talking about. I mean, what do you mean I can't bring a horse into an elevator? Well, he ain't smoking and he's facing front.
It's just not gonna work, Dennis. I mean, you should have stuck with Gunsmoke. I mean, you were really great as Matt Dillon's sidekick.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's true, Rich, but I just got sick and tired of being kicked in the side.
No, I think your detective character, Dennis, needs a completely different approach. Maybe a style like Peter Falk in Columbo.
Excuse me, sir. I know that you're the murderer. You'd better come with me right away. Oh, by the way, that's a really nice looking gun that you're pointing at me.
No, Dennis, let's face it. That McCloud character is just not gonna work. I mean, it's about as out of place as Truman Capote trying to be a detective.
You criminal crook.
Beat you within an inch of your life. Because it's because of you I talk this way. You see, you're the creep who sold me these tight shorts.
In fact, let me tell you something, Dennis. There's a lot of other people who could give a completely different approach to McCloud. For instance, Paul Lynn as a detective.
Hi. Is that the victim lying there in that Charisse safari suit? The cute body shirt and the mocha suede Gucci's? Well, I know what he died of. Bad taste.
Many people in our industry have said that Mike Connors is a consummate thespian. I won't contradict that because I don't know what thespian means. Boy, I wish I was here.
How are you, Dean?
My partner, well, man.
To say a few words about the crowd.
Hi, Dennis. Now, look, I don't know about the rest of you on the dais here, how you got here, but as for me, I want to tell you how Dennis got me here. In my case, it all began with a letter. At first, I thought this was just a piece of junk mail, and then I saw it was from Dennis Weaver, and I knew it was junk mail. Now, as I started to read this letter, it was obvious to me that, well... Dennis was actually kind of searching for some people to be here on the dais tonight. Really looking. I don't want to imply that he was desperate, and he sent these letters to a lot of people. But the invitation began, "Dear Occupant." Would you bother reserving a room? You'll be sharing my suite. Well, let me tell you, folks, I am sharing a suite, and I'll never do it again. I mean, all night long, his horse keeps kicking the blankets off of the bed. Oh, and Dennis, by the way, I think you better rush out to the lobby. Your horse was just picked up on a 502. That's molesting a Mustang.
Gentlemen, one of Hollywood's finest actors, Mr. Milton Berle, Stone Berle, Milton, Milburn Stern.
Dennis, Amanda, this is really like old times. You know, you sitting there on your duffs and me working. As Gunsmoke started to go up in the ratings, it was then the famous Dennis Weaver ego was born. I'll give you an example. Very short time later, he came to me and he said, "Milburn, I'm going to have my own show someday." Well, I humored him. I said, "Okay, Dennis, what's it going to be called?" He said, "Gunsmoke." It was then that he started his legendary Dump Arness campaign.
Don't believe it, Jim. Don't believe it.
Little simple things at first, like he turned out the lights while Jim was cleaning his gun. Little things like that. If anybody's wondering why Jim isn't here, well, Dean asked me to invite him, and I did. Jim said, well, he'd like to come on the show, but he didn't know what to do. And I said, well, all you have to do is come on the show and insult Dennis. Say nasty things about it. And he said, what show is it, to tell the truth? Eventually, Dennis rode out of Dodge City for the last time. Now, for the rest of us on the show, after we'd polished off all the champagne, we put up some barricades to make sure he didn't change his mind.
Ago on the Gunsmoke series, they auditioned a lot of dance hall girls for the Long Branch Saloon. With us tonight is one of those young girls who, you know, one of those young dancing girls. Here she is to tell us her very unique story, ladies and gentlemen, Miss Gladys Ormsby.
Ormsby! me backstage. He told everybody I looked like a gold digger. John Sutter. You, Roman Rummy, be quiet. You could have had all of this also, Dennis. That's right. I offered him my lips, my heart, my soul, but he decided to go for what's behind door number two. And he got what he deserved, a toaster and a picture of George Hamilton for his wallet. I'll never forget the day I auditioned. I walked out on that Long Branch stage in my leotards. Ah, hold it down over there. I tell you, I turned quite a few heads.
And quite a few stomachs.
He told me I was beautiful. He made my bosom swell. That was something I always wanted. A swell bosom. You know, I became his completely. Why? I don't know. He was so conceited. Every night, he'd walk into the girls' dressing room and say, Dennis, anyone? You know, I remember the first gift he gave me. He asked me if I wanted a fur coat. I said, yes. So he gave me a razor and told me to go and shave Gentle Ben. And our first Christmas together, he bought me two silver bowls. One marked food and the other marked water. You insensitive monster. You know, I told him I wanted a white Christmas. He shoved me into a bowl of cheese dip. Those years, do you think it was fun for me going with a guy who's got a limp? I'll tell you, it was a drag.
Just to come here.
I'll take it here.
Lovely. Our next guest, Nippus here, Russell. He a black performer. He's the only black comedian without his own situation comedy. Ladies and gentlemen, here's one of the funniest guys in show business, my pal.
I only have one thing to say to you, Mr. McLeod. Don't ride that damn horse through Harlem no more. The black people in Harlem were celebrating, they were playing James Brown's record. Say it loud, I'm black and I'm proud. And here he comes on the horse. Do you know they thought you were the white knight and that you were going to make everybody white? Now it's beautiful to be black. Nobody wants to be bleached. Now, I just want to direct most of my commentary to this assemblage of great television policemen. Gentlemen, your concept of law enforcement is all wrong, and the jury trial is a joke. How can you lock 12 men and women in a hotel overnight and they come out and say, not guilty? Huh. Now, since they have announced the budget crisis in New York, we black people have learned something about the police. We didn't know the city was paying them too. Well, you know, it's not just in New York. Right here last night at the MGM Grand Hotel, we got a phone call. It said, hurry over with help. There's a burglar trapped in Tony Field's house, and we think there's a plan for sexual violence. Hurry up. We said, we're coming. Is this Tony Fields talking? He said, no, this is the burglar. I have totally omitted any reference to the whole Gunsmoke thing. There's been a great disservice done to my people in the historical context of all the Westerns on television. Now, you know General Custer was black. When he got the little big horn and saw all the Indians in the world waiting for him, then he turned white. So I say to you, McLeod, go on with your great series. Don't worry about a losing streak, because even if your ratings fall down, Columbo will pick them up next week.
It's a pleasure for me to introduce the poster girl for Cartier, the lovely Miss Zsa Zsa Gabor.
I watch all of your shows and I love them. But you know what you really need is a policewoman for a partner like me. After all, who knows more about getting her man than I do? And I will be a very honest cop. Who can afford to bribe me? Believe me, I know all about police work. I always hear you say 10:40, 9:11, 2:36. I have been in every one of those hotel rooms. Let's face it, darling. Nobody could ever accuse me of carrying concealed weapons. And Dennis, darling, I'm an original member of the SWAT team. SWAT, Salvi at Tiffany's. I love you.
Zsa Gabor is staying here at the MGM Grand Hotel in the honeymoon suite as an instructor. Georgia Engel. She is the sweetest and the nicest lady you have ever seen. In fact, she's so nice that whenever she breaks an egg, she sends a get well card to the chicken. Anger. Georgia.
When I was asked to do this Dennis Weaver roast, they asked me to come up with some hard-hitting zingers. Well, I thought and I thought and I thought, but I still couldn't zing right, so the producer gave me things to say about the people on the dais. Some raps, some slams, and some put-down shtick. Here's the first one. I see Milton Berle sitting over there in a tuxedo. I guess his dress didn't come back from the cleaners.
Was a good zinger.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Burrell. You know, I don't know why they keep on poking fun of you because you wear dresses on television. I've always thought you have a lovely figure. Well, here's another zinger. And how do you like Zsa Zsa Gabor's hair color? I don't know where she gets it done, but last week I saw her coming out of Earl Shives. Let's go. That wasn't very nice. Their hair looks so perfectly natural, especially at the roots. Dean Martin was recently honored in Hollywood, where they put stars' names on the sidewalk. Dean was the first one to get his name in the gutter. The most terrible thing to say, Mr. Martin. I can't picture you anyway except spread out on the sidewalk. And now we come to our guest of honor, Dennis Weaver. Dennis is really a health nut. In fact, he eats so much health food that when he dies, he's not going to be buried, he's going to be blended. Mr. Weaver, just before the show, he gave me one of his health drinks. Half of it was desiccated liver, brewer's yeast and texturized vegetable protein, and the other half was tomato juice. It's called a bloody mess.
Gentlemen, a glamorous lady, a fine actress, the queen of Gunsmoke, Miss Amanda Blake.
Thank you, Dean. You know, I always love to do your show here at the MGM Grand. It's really the most magnificent place in Las Vegas. It makes all the other hotels look like the Long Branch. Dennis, of course, created the part of Chester, a slow-witted character with a limp. In doing so, he drew upon his past experiences. The limp he perfected during the war, when he appeared before his draft board. But that was Chester, slow-witted with a limp. Not to be confused with the real-life Dennis, who does not limp. Of course, Dennis became immensely popular as Chester, but his success didn't change him. He still treated us with the same petty jealousy he always had. For example, Milburn, Jim Arness, and I all had air conditioners in our dressing rooms. So Dennis demanded that he wanted one, too. But they turned him down because they were afraid the horses would catch cold. But things have changed for Dennis. He's the star of his own series, McCloud. And now he has a huge dressing room with air conditioning and a barrel of Dristan for his horse.
By the way, Amanda is no relation to Robert Blake. Robert asked me to say that. Ladies and gentlemen, one of TV's most popular and most capable actors, my wonderful buddy, Mr. Peter Graves.
He invited me here tonight to say a lot of nice things about Dennis, but I told him that I'm through with Mission Impossible. Well, I'm happy that tonight I'm the one who gets to tell you that the Patrol Women's Benevolent Association has voted you the best-looking police officer on television. I was supposed to present you with the award tonight, but they're having trouble getting it back from last year's winner, Carl Malden. Now, just before the show, I was talking with the president of that group, and I agree with her. I think that McLeod has been the victim of a lot of cruel and undue criticism tonight. I've seen every one of your shows, and I love both the plots. Now, everybody watches McLeod these days, of course. In fact, McLeod's ratings are so good that they're planning a spin-off, and it's based on Dennis's sexual relationship with his girlfriend, Barbara. It's called The Rookies.
McLeod, Dennis Weaver doesn't really hang from helicopters, jump from buildings, and chase people on horseback. He has a stuntman to do all those dangerous things. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Dennis Weaver's stuntman, a guy with real courage and nerves of steel, Mr. Foster Brooks.
I've been a stuntman on the cloud right from the very beginning. And you know what? Why? Because he's chicken. Now let me tell you a few things about the faint-hearted fuzz. And you want to know something else about Dens? He's afraid of horses. You think he's not scared? He won't even get on one unless he's wearing Pampers. Do you want to know something else? You want to know something else about him? That isn't even his voice. His real voice is extremely high-pitched. For a long time, he was known as Dennis Weaver. One final bit of information regarding my job. As you know, the inadequate investigator here has three kids. That was my greatest stunt.
The man who pioneered television, Mr. Tuesday Night, and I say Mr. Milton Berle.
You call me Mr. Tuesday Night?
It's funny, that's what my wife still calls me. You did it again, Dean. What a night. There's more losers at this table than are out there in the casino. There it is. It's like a live wax museum. Look who's the man of the week. Dennis Weaver. Poor soul. He thinks the happy hooker specializes in needlepoint. Incidentally, Dennis, I have regards for you from Guy Lombardo. He told me when he dies, he's going to take New Year's Eve with him. That's a joke I used 30 years ago. And there's not too many things I used 30 years ago that I can still use, but I would like. Sergeant, I hear you feel like a new man. And look, wait, Dennis. Will you look at me, please, please? Look at the people that showed up for you tonight. Bill Conrad, where is he? Sitting over there under very difficult circumstances. Any minute he could give birth. It's a
front, he looks like Toady Fields from the back. And then there's lovely Ruth Buzzy, the fashion coordinator for the Walton family. Gosh, she could make veils popular again. George Hamilton. Hamilton is the only one I know that makes movies that are immediately shown on the Late Late Show. Manic, great detective. He couldn't find Raquel Welch in a phone booth. There's Jim Hutton, Ellery Queen. Jim, stop talking to that beautiful girl. Star of Ellery Queen. He has the only show that's listed in TV Guide in pencil. My pal, Nipsey Russell, sitting over there smiling at everybody with Burt Lancaster's teeth. Look at him. Nipsey has gums that shine. Well, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said Nipsey and Shine in the same voice. Tell you about your friend, Mr. Remember us, the defiant ones? What is Amanda Blake doing here besides being a... I mean, she doesn't need this. She's a very rich woman. She made a fortune endorsing kitty litter. And I think... Here's another one you may not care for. I'm laughing at the next joke because I heard it. Glad to see the two and only Zsa Zsa. Sitting over there wearing a rented bracelet. Great lady. My girl, Zsa Zsa. My girl. Everybody's girl. Jazz has been married so many times, she's got rice marks on her face. It's an old joke. Well, who am I talking to? Shelley Winters. Lovely. She and I go back a very long time. Shelley used to travel with the Tommy Dorsey band. She didn't sing, she just liked to travel with the band. And now we get to our guest of honor. When they call out the names of the great actors, Marlon Brando, Sir Laurence Olivier, Paul Newman, Dennis, you'll be there, listening.
One of the most respected and talented stars and actors of our profession, Mr. Dennis Weaver.
You know, I really didn't think it was possible for a group of entertainers like yourself to get together and do funny jokes about me for an hour. And I was right. You know, I look forward to being here because, well, to be very truthful with you, I feel a great kinship with Dean. We both love doing westerns. We both have a 10-gallon hat. Except Dean's has a cork in it. Anyway, I'm happy to see my friend Peter Graves here. As you know, Peter is James Arnett's brother. You can see a very definite family resemblance. They're both out of work. And Milburn Stone, my old friend from Gunsmoke, Milburn Stone,
You know, I tell you that, Wilbert, he's really got a down-home sense of humor. And I think that's where he left it. And Georgia Engel.
Oh, listen, I always watch you on the Mary Tyler Moore Show, always.
I really like that, Georgia. She's so friendly. You know, she starts sing-alongs in crowded elevators. And gracing this dais tonight is another alumnus of Gunsmoke, Amanda Blake. You came here out of affection. You also came here out of material. And Bill Conrad, I remember when they roasted you on this show. I didn't think they could find a rotisserie that was big enough. Nipsey Russell, you are the best at what you do. I just wish I knew what it was. I knew I'd see Shelley Winters here. Last night, 3 o'clock in the morning, I saw Shelley. She's getting into an elevator with a handy six-pack. She had 3 guys under each arm. You know, if there's anything that makes me sad and sometimes makes me a little mad, it's hearing people say that Milton Berle isn't funny. You know, I mean, heck, he knows that.